Hey everybody, Robin from Backscatter here.
Jim from Backscatter here.
And in this video, we're going to be answering one of the most commonly asked questions that we get at Backscatter, which is, can I use a video light instead of a strobe for shooting stills underwater? We know that the answer to this question is really, a strobe is the best tool for the job when shooting stills, but there's always some exceptions to that rule, right?
There are some exceptions, but they are few and far between.
So what we're going to do is, in this video, explain, first of all, why you need a light in general for underwater photography, then how strobes and video lights differ from each other, and what you can and can't do with a video light when it comes to shooting stills. So what do you say we dive in?
All right, let's take a look.
So Jim, let's start with first things first. Why do we need a light, whether it be strobe or video light, for underwater photography in the first place?
Well, a light is going to highlight your foreground subject. Your foreground subject is going to be the most important part of your image. So you want to draw attention to it. By shining a light on it, you'll do that. In addition to that, you're also going to get back any lost reds, get the color back to it as well, and you'll be able to separate it from the background and maintain a darker background to really give the image some interest.
So how is a strobe actually different than a video light when it comes to shooting stills underwater? Like, how do they work?
Right, so a strobe is an instantaneous amount of light in a very short duration, but it's very, very bright. For a video light, the video light is on constantly. Mm-hmm. So the duration of it is basically forever until your battery runs out, I guess. Mm-hmm. But it's nowhere near as bright as a strobe.
So let's quantify this. How much brighter is a strobe than a video light?
Well, Robin, we have the studio scene set up here that we shot with the YSD3 strobe at full power, and also the Kelvin video light at 18,000 lumens, which is its full power setting. What we found is if we use the same aperture and shutter speed and just vary the ISO, then we can find out the difference. So 1/125th, we found that the strobe is actually about 26 times brighter than the video light. And if we actually go the full sync speed limit of what the Sony A1 can do at 1/400th of a second, we found that's about 104 times brighter. So it's a heck of a lot more light coming from the strobe than it is from a video light. There's a couple of practical things that creep into photography as well between a flash and a video light as well. So back this up a little bit. If you think about the three controls you have on your camera for exposure, you have aperture, ISO, and shutter speed. Uh-huh. Well, aperture and ISO will affect all the amount of light that comes into the camera. So that's whether it's a flash or a video light or the natural ambient light. Uh-huh. Now, when we get the shutter speed, here's the trick. The flash is going to be faster than the shutter speed. So therefore, it's not subject to the shutter speed. So the shutter speed, when you're dealing with flash photography, the shutter speed only affects the ambient light, not the flash light. Whereas with a video light, the shutter speed, because the video light is on all the time, it is subject to the shutter speed, and any shutter speed changes will also affect how the video light appears in your image. Which also brings us to kind of the next point, is the strobe. Because it's such a short duration, when I was shooting at the quarter power on the strobe, the duration of the flash is around 1/3000, if you express it like a shutter speed.
Okay.
So it's way faster than shutter speed, and that will also freeze motion where the light, because it's on all the time, does nothing to freeze motion. Uh-huh. You need your shutter speed to freeze motion. So you want to have a shutter speed fast enough to freeze the motion, but that being said, you're competing with the ambient light. So if you change your shutter speed, you're also going to affect the video light. So that's where you're going to be on a balance of trying to get a shutter speed fast enough to freeze motion, but also not knock down the exposure of the video light too much.
Let's take a look at an example image to kind of get a better idea of what we're talking about here.
Great. So I have two examples here for an image. They're both the same subject, both shot exactly the same way. The only difference between them is the shutter speed. So the aperture, the ISO, the strobe output, all the same. In one image, you can see that the background is darker. The other image, you can see the background is brighter. The darker image background, that is a faster shutter speed. In the brighter image background, that is a slower shutter speed. As you can see, nothing else has changed on my settings, and the shutter speed has zero effect on the foreground, which is being lit by the strobe. So that's how we're able to separate our exposure between our foreground and background by using a flash and shutter speed.
So that's a great example of how the strobe works. Now, can we take a look at how the video light's affected in that same kind of situation?
Yes, I have another set of images here, so let's take a look at them. In this first shot here, I have the video light illuminating the foreground, and I get a pretty good exposure on the foreground, but the background is so bright, it's kind of overexposed for what I want for an underwater photo. So the only thing I can do is just lower the exposure overall on the camera. In this case, I did shutter speed and a little bit of aperture, get the exposure down. But now my background looks great, but now my foreground is underlit and I'm already at full power on the video light. Now, if you look at a third image here, this is shot with a strobe. In this one, I'm able to get best of both worlds. I've got a nice brightly lit foreground and a nice dark blue background. And I'm able to do that because I can separate the ambient exposure for the background from the strobe exposure using my shutter speed. In addition to the strobe being many magnitude times brighter than a video light.
So if that's a really clear example of why the video light doesn't work well for photographs, are there any examples where it can work for photographs?
There are certain situations where it will work for photographs, and those situations are all going to be low ambient light conditions.
Okay, so what does that mean for us underwater?
So it means, low ambient light, well, at nighttime, you're not competing with anything at that point. Inside a dark wreck, inside of a cave, during the daytime, it would be on like a deep on a shadow wall. Those kind of situations will work decently. The other is if you're doing super close up macro with compact cameras, because compact cameras don't need as much light, they typically have their apertures are more open for their max aperture. So those situations, it'll work in some situations as well.
So we had a couple of pretty good example shots that really demonstrate the concepts you're talking about there. You want to take a look at those too?
Let's take a look. This particular shot here, this is shot by Becca Boring, our operations manager. She was in Truck Lagoon inside of a wreck where there's no ambient light whatsoever. And so a video light works well illuminating the area because you have no ambient light to compete with. Also, when you're inside a wreck and it's pitch black, you need a light of your own to see where you're going. And so it kind of doubles as both your light to see things, and also you're already seeing what it's lighting up. You don't have to worry about strobe position because you'd already see where it's going to. This is where it's actually sometimes preferred to use a video light in this situation as opposed to a strobe. Here's another one from Becca in Truck. On this photo, she's at about 150 feet deep or so, but it's later in the afternoon, so there's not a lot of ambient light to compete with. So there's enough illumination from the video lights to make this photo work. This is an example I shot at Little Cayman, and I was down on the wall at about 90 feet under an overhang, trying to find an area that I could use the video lights to take a decent photo. I had these video lights at full blast on this, and I had to get super close to it just to maintain this exposure. The background looks pretty decent for the depth that I'm at. I might wanna, if I was doing a photo with the strobe, I might make the background a little bit darker, but I couldn't. This is the max I could do. Now when I use strobes, the photo doesn't look too much different, but the thing is I'm at quarter power on this strobe. I could do all sorts of stuff. I could separate it by using my shutter speed to make the background darker or background brighter. I could increase the power of the strobe if I wanted to. So I have a lot more leeway in it. While the shot does work with the video light, it's right on the edge of working.
Hey everybody, hope you're enjoying this video. You know, you can join our family by buying your underwater photo and video gear from us here at Backscatter. Every purchase includes free lifetime tech support, will beat any price, hands down, and we ship worldwide daily. Our in-house authorized warranty service center has you covered for any maintenance and repairs. Here at Backscatter, we dive, shoot, and service everything we sell. Whether you're point and shoot or professional, we look forward to helping you meet your underwater imaging goals. Now back to the video. Those were some great wide angle examples, but you also mentioned that it's possible to work in macro too. So let's take a look at that.
Yeah, macro is a little bit easier to deal with, especially compact cameras. So there's an example here with a TG camera. And with TG camera, you get really close to the foreground subjects for macro. Therefore, you can get the light in really, really tight. And when you do that, the light appears so bright to the camera, it tricks the camera into doing a higher shutter speed. When you do that, then it knocks out the rest of the ambient light, and then you get a dark background, but you still have a nicely lit foreground.
So that's sort of a consequence of working well because you get so close with a TG. What about on a more traditional camera setup? How's it work?
Right, so I was shooting with a full-frame Sony mirrorless camera for macro, a 90mm macro lens. So I kept my shutter speed at 1/125th because I didn't want to introduce motion blur into my shot because it's 90mm focal length. And usually the rule of thumb is 1/1 focal length. So the next one up I did was 1/125th. F22 because I wanted to get depth of field. And then I had to have it at ISO 640, and I had the Backscatter macro wide 4300 lumen video light right at the front port with the macro beam on at full blast, which is one of the brightest beams out of a light for exposure value that's out there. And yeah, I had to be at ISO 640 to make that happen. However, next shot I took with it, I used the Backscatter mini flash, and that one, I didn't even have to be at full power. I was two or three clicks down on it to be able to illuminate the subject, no problem, and have a complete black background at that point as well. Because I can then get my ISO down, I can get shutter speed up, make black backgrounds, and then the flash will actually freeze the motion and gives it another level of crispness. So I think that while you could use it for a compact camera and get good results, when you're dealing with bigger cameras with bigger sensors, that's where it starts to get in the territory of being on the bubble of working or not.
Are there any other benefits or drawbacks to using a video light when shooting macro like that? Because it doesn't seem like it's as much of a deal breaker as it is for wide angle.
It's not as much of a deal breaker. The benefits to it are, number one, you can just look over the top of your rig there and is light hitting my subject because it's always on. So it's very easy for positioning of lighting for someone who's new to underwater photography.
Okay.
We have a whole section in our TG6 review video on how to use the TG6 with macro with a video light.
We'll be sure to link that in the video description as well.
The other aspect that is a little bit easier for some people is it can be completely automatic. You don't need to manually adjust a strobe for your exposure underwater because it's now working off of the meter, because the meter only works for constant light. It doesn't work for light from a flash. So there is a benefit to that as well for someone who's kind of new to things, doesn't want to adjust the level of a strobe. They can do that. That being said, some strobes out there do well with TTL for macro. So little six on one hand, half dozen on the other. However, the drawback is that when you're using a video light for macro, it's really only good for macro. And I mean macro, I mean small things. We're talking like small nudibranchs, things that are only inches away from the lens. If you're trying to do fish porch with it, the light is not strong enough. It's not going to go far enough to actually illuminate a fish portrait unless you're doing that on a night dive.
So I know there are some products out there that are a constant source LED video light that claim to have like a burst or a strobe mode on them. What's the deal there? Is that really a two for one kind of thing?
Well, keep in mind, these are LED video lights. They are not flashes. They do not have a flash tube. There's no capacitors. So it is not a flash. It is a LED video light that then has a boost to the LED lighting. So what happens is you're back in the same problem with a video light. These lights tend to be small, have smaller batteries. They're not going to put out the amount of light as the Kelvin does at 18,000 lumens. Some of these, if you're talking 5,000, 10,000 lumens, maybe on the burst mode to it. Also, the burst mode is much longer duration than what a flash is. It's going to be longer than your shutter speed, so it's still going to appear as a video light to the camera, meaning that you cannot separate your shutter speed for your foreground and background exposure like you do with an actual real bona fide flash.
Jim, thanks very much for that detailed explanation and the great example images that really do prove why a strobe is what you want over a video light for still photography. But in some cases, it's good to know they can work.
In some cases they can, but most places it's better to use a flash.
For sure, for sure. If you have any more questions about this topic or really anything underwater photo and video related, you can always give us a call here at Backscatter, and you can help us keep making more of these videos by supporting us by buying your underwater photo and video gear from us. Every purchase includes free lifetime tech support. We ship internationally every day, and we actually dive, shoot, and service everything we sell. I'm Robin from Backscatter, signing off.
I'm Jim from Backscatter, signing off.
And we'll see you on the next one.